Today in biology, we're looking at something called standard deviation. And before we talk about that, we need to look at why measures like the mean and the range are no good for us in biology anymore. So in the past, we talked about the average. Of course, we're at A-level now, so we never actually use that word average. We talk about mean, median, or mode. And you also need to be able to explain those. So let's have a think about it. With the mean, obviously in your A-level exam paper, they know that you know how to calculate the mean, but what they will ask you is, how do you calculate the mean? And so this word value is really important. You're gonna say, add all the values and divide by the number of values. So that answers that question. The next thing that they'll ask you is about the median. The median is the middle number. So of course what you need to say is that you will line the values in ascending order. Line the values up in ascending order. Then you will count the values, divide by 2, and that should identify the middle number. Of course, if you've got an even set of numbers, then you're going to have 2 numbers in the middle, and you need to add those up and divide by 2. Now, none of that is rocket science, it's all GCSE, and of course, the mode is the number that occurs the most. So none of that is rocket science. But let's have a look at why the mean isn't very good for us anymore. So I can have, just imagine any experiment, I could have a mean of 30. And that 30 could be derived from 29, 30, and 31. But my mean is 30. Likewise, I could have a set of values that are 20, 30, and 40. And my mean is 30. So the mean isn't very good anymore because it doesn't tell me how spread around the mean my values are. So I need something more. So straight away, you're thinking, well, why don't we use the range? The range would tell us that here it's plus or minus 1, and here it's plus or minus 10. However, even with that, I could have sets of results that are 20, 21, 21, 21, 30. I could have results that go 39, 39, 39, and 40. And the mean is 30 and the range is 20 because it's plus or minus 10. And over here, I could have the exact same range, the exact same mean, but my numbers might be distributed differently. I might have 29, 29, and 29. I might have 31, 31, and 31. Both sets of numbers give me the same mean and the same range, but they're both very different sets of results. These would be considered outliers in this set of results, but they wouldn't be considered outliers in this set of results. So we need something different, and that's where we come to this equation called the standard deviation. So if I just jump to the very, very end point of standard deviation, and then I'll tell you how we get there. The very end point of standard deviation tells me the variation of each figure away from the mean. So in the example I just used, it would tell me, it would take into account that each of these figures were that far away from the mean, that that figure was that far away from the mean, that that figure was that far, that that figure was that far. It takes into account the variation of your data around the mean and how far it is. And from that, it gives us a number. And on its own, that number doesn't tell us very much. However, ultimately, the end point of where we're going to is that you will have perhaps a set of data. You might have the mean height, for example, of boys in year seven. And you might have another bar that tells us the mean height of boys in year nine. And the question might be, is there a difference in the means? And what you will do is you will work out the standard deviation. And ultimately you will get a number. And that number might be, I'm just making it up, plus or minus 3.2. So from your mean, you'll put something on there called an error bar, and the error bar will be the same height up as it is down, because that number is given to us by the equation for standard deviation, and we're just gonna plot it. And if we get an error bar like that, again, that on its own doesn't tell us very much, until we compare it to the other error bar. Now, again, with year nine, perhaps the variance of data. In year seven, if you think about it, all the boys are pretty much about the same height. But by year nine, you see friends walking around, and someone's really tall and someone's really short. There's a lot more variation around the mean. So my standard deviation here might be much bigger because the spread of data around the mean is much greater. Now, the key thing here is that these bars, these error bars, overlap. And one word that we're never going to say when we're talking about standard deviation is the word significance. Because significance is a word we use for statistical tests, but not standard deviation. All we can say with standard deviation is how likely means are to be different or the same. So the fact that these error bars overlap tells us that the difference in the means is due to chance. So if I write that down, because this is critical, error bars overlap, the difference in the means is likely to be due to chance. So we're saying, although we've got different means, they're not really different. And the reason why we're saying they're not really different is because some of the values around the mean are similar, and therefore, although we've got a different mean, it's likely to be due to chance. Now, let's assume that the error bars don't overlap, which is probably more likely to be the case in this example when we're talking about the heights of year seven boys and year nine. So if we plot, if the value that our equation gives us a standard deviation plus and minus, and that bars don't overlap, then what we're going to say is that the difference, bars don't overlap, we're going to say that the difference in the means is not likely to be due to chance. In other words, they are likely to be different. We can't say they are different, because further statistical tests will tell us exactly whether they are or not. But it's the first line of thinking, are they different or aren't they? Are they likely to be different or are they likely not to be different? And that's where we go with the standard deviation. So let me now take you back to looking at how we actually calculate the standard deviation and what it means. So, in biology, if you get a large enough sample size, it doesn't matter what you measure, you get a spread of data that's called the normal distribution. And that means that most of your measurements are going to be in the middle, and they're going to be, you're going to have a lot of people around the mean. This would be your mean. And then you'll have a few outliers on one end and a few outliers on the other. Now, what the actual standard deviation tells us, so again, if we use this as our example for height of boys in the secondary school, for example, you'll have a few people who are really, really tall, a lot of people who are average height, and a few people who are very, very small. Now, when we work out the standard deviation, what that actually tells us is, just like we've got plotted here, a plus or a minus around the mean. It's showing us the variance around the mean. If we plot that on this graph here, what it's going to give us is a plus or a minus around the mean. And just the way it is, the statisticians who came up with the formula, what it tells us is that 68.2 or 3% of our values lie within that range of plus or minus one standard deviation. If I take two standard deviations and add it to a bar chart, and like if I add it to my normal distribution, what I am saying is that 95% of my values lie within that range. So for example, I read recently on the A-level essay question that you get in paper 3 in A2, and the exam board wrote that the mean mark out of 25 is 13 with a standard deviation of 4. So that means 68% of people have a mark between 9, 13 minus 4, or 17, 13 plus 4. So you know. And statisticians, the question will always tell you whether to apply one standard deviation or two standard deviations before you start saying whether something is likely to be due to chance. So let's just have a look, therefore, at how we actually calculate the standard deviation. And you've got a booklet, and in this booklet it talks about plus or minus two standard deviations. Actually, in your exam, you'll see that they just refer to plus or minus one standard deviation. Who has decided that? Depends what you're looking at. Some statisticians might say you can only decide if that's likely to be due to chance or not if you apply two standard deviations. Other times, they'll say apply one. So that's not for you to worry about. You can just...
Okay, so how do we actually pull this standard deviation calculation together, and what does it look like?
So standard deviation is equal to the sum of x, which is one of your values, minus x bar, which is the mean, squared over n minus 1 and 2, the square root, and the square root goes over the whole equation. So what do these values mean? Well, this one we know is the sum of x is any one of our values. We're going to put each of our values in there. X bar is the mean of our sample, and n is our sample size, and so n minus 1 is whatever the sample is, minus 1. So when we look at n, and we use in biology n minus 1, a quick recap of the reason for that is, if you, with a standard deviation, it's descriptive statistics. You're looking at a group and it is what it is. So if we imagine, for example, that you're filling a football team with the positions, you've got a goalie, a centre forward, a striker, and so on, and you've got 11 players. So each person you might choose for a role
But by the time you've put the last person, you've got the last person there and the last space to fill, there's no question about which space they're going to fill. There's only one space. So we don't need to think of filling a football team as 11 choices. We think of filling a football team as 10 choices. And that's why we use N minus 1 in biology. A couple of other things. If we look here, each of these is our values. And we're going to minus the mean. Well, the mean generally sits in the middle of those values. So you're going to have some numbers that are smaller than the mean, and you're going to be minusing the mean. So therefore, if we square that, we get rid of our negative numbers. So let's just make some data up. Again, let's think of the some heights of boys in year seven. So if I think I've got someone who's 150 centimetres, 160, 163, 170, 172. They are my values. Each of those is X. And what I want to do now is work out my mean. So I'm going to add them all up and divide by the number. So my mean is 164. So to work this out, what I need to now do is plug all of these into the calculation. And again, you won't get asked to do this in an exam because it takes too long. There is an easier way to do it on a calculator, but you don't actually need to learn to do that. So it would look something like this. I'm going to have 150, which is that value, minus 164. I'm going to square it. Then I'm going to add 160 minus 164. I'm going to get a negative number, but it ends up squared. 163 minus 164 squared, because again 164 is my average. 170 minus 164 squared. 172 minus 164 squared. I'm going to add all of those together. I'm going to divide it by n minus 1. In this case, I've got 5 values, so before. And I'm going to square root it. And that's going to give me my number. And again, what do I then do with my number? I'm going to plus or minus it from my mean. Here's my mean. This is the mean height of boys in year 7. So when I add my error bars, I'm going to add those on either side. And when I put my year 9 ones, perhaps it looks like this. There's no overlap. So I'm saying that it's likely that the difference in those means is not due to chance. Further statistical tests will tell me if it's significantly different. If those error bars overlap, then what I'm going to say is that it is likely that the difference in those means are due to chance. In other words, I've got different numbers, but it doesn't mean to say that the means are massively different, because some of the values of year 7 boys will be the heights of some boys in year 9, and some of the boys in year 9 will be the height of year 7 boys. So there's an overlap. You'll see in your handout exactly what we've talked about today, and how when you find the mean, plus or minus one standard deviation is 68.2% of your population or your sample size. Two standard deviations is 95%, 95.4 actually. And it will give you some examples, and it shows you very clearly how to split up your working. Now, in an exam, you will never be asked to do that calculation because it basically takes too much time, and the reward for it in terms of marks doesn't equal the time that you need to put in. What they will ask you is to interpret information from a graph like this. And what you're looking for is, do the error bars overlap? If they do overlap, we're likely to say that the difference in means is due to chance. In other words, you've got a different mean, but it doesn't really mean anything. If the error bars don't overlap, what we're going to say is the difference in means is not likely to be due to chance. Therefore, there may be a difference, but we don't know that until we do more statistical tests. And that's why we use this word, likely. We can't say it is or it isn't or how likely. We're just going to say that. So these sentences are really worth you learning just to get into the pattern of it. And the other thing to note is never to use the word significance when we're talking about standard deviation. That is a word we come back to later with more statistical tests, and that we'll use that a lot later, but we never apply it to standard deviation. So what you need to do is make sure that on this handout that we've given you, that you can follow the two examples that are in there, and also there's two questions at the end for you to have a go at also.